Hello, Malty Malt Falcons. I'm Ralphie, and that malt mention announces, as it does, another review. And I was going to say whiskey review, but we're not actually reviewing whiskey. We're having a malternative moment, and we're going to be reviewing some rums, the three that I have stacked up here in the barrel. They're about to be reviewed. But before we go any further, an acknowledgement for that malt moment, oh yes indeed, to Leonid Torti for the malt mention. Thank you, Leonid. And I wonder if Leonid is an explorer like I am. Yes, because many of us, we know the Scotch single malts and a few of the quality blends. We're familiar with them. But it's always good to expand our horizons. Whatever we happen to be drinking, whether it be whiskey, bourbon, rye, rum, tequila, mezcal, and all the other quality spirits around the world. A change is as good as a rest. And at this moment in time, I'm going to introduce some alternatives for Scotch whisky drinkers. So I have another hat on today. The bunnet is hanging up in the peg, and we have a rum hat on. This is the hat that when I go to hot countries, I squash it into the suitcase, and it combines with giving me a little bit of shade, because being a northern boy, I tend to burn up in the sun quite easily. It's just one of these things. But importantly, it's got lots of little holes in it, so if there's any cool breezes blowing, it helps to keep my head rather cool in some hot tropical situations. Whereas where this, and of course these hot tropical situations is where you find these little beauties, rums. Rum is the most produced spirit in the world, in my opinion. It is. It's the most geographically diverse, and it's interesting that when moonshiners and illicit distillers start to do their stuff, depending where you are, whether it's illegal to distill or not in your country, check it out, malt mates. One of the easiest things to distill is, in fact, sugar. It's the easiest ingredient to get hold of, and it doesn't require to be malted such as barley would, or mashed as corn would. And mind you, a word of warning, if you try and ferment sugar, as in bags of white refined sugar, not natural sugar cane juice, it's rather hard to get started. I recommend that you kick your fermentation off if you happen to be making some sugar wine, why not, with a tin of prunes. First of our rums is Penny Blue from Mauritius. This is a multiple award-winning rum from the Indian Ocean, oh indeedy, and it has a very good reputation. It's a batched rum. This particular batch is batch number, where is it? Where is it? Batch number 4, bottled at 43.3%, and it says, interestingly, and I do want to highlight this, on the label it says non-chill filtered and natural colour. That's a good sign. All rums from the Indian Ocean and from Asia are fascinating and different from Caribbean and South American rums. It's one of the first things we need to understand. They have a different character, a different delivery. They're a different experience. And this isn't generally picked up on malt mates, rum rascals, because by far the majority of rums in the world are not sipped neat. They are used in cocktails and long drinks. So they're mixed with Coca-Cola, coconut water, lemonade, tonic. In fact, when I started out, way back in the mists of time, drinking spirits, my favourite tipple was a dark rum and tonic. Second of our rums is going to be Hechicera from Colombia, a Spanish for the Enchantress. This is a rarely available rum for Colombia. We now get rums from Panama, from Belize, from Peru, But this is the first one I've come across from Colombia. Very interesting experience, this, because it's got a lot of character. And finally, third of my rums is going to be RumBlender. Now, you may remember a while back, I reviewed Whiskey Blender, where you go to a website and you look at the option, the recipe available to you, the ingredients, and you actually blend your own whiskey. And now the same company have got a stock of different rums, and they're offering you the choice of 7 different rum options, which you can mix, blend for yourself to create your own individual personalized rum. I'll go into this more shortly. There we go. For whiskey drinkers, it's good to have a change. One can become quite institutionalized in what we drink, in the way we perceive drinks. We start to overrate some reputable drinks, and equally we underrate other drinks which we don't normally encounter. It's a really exciting time in 2016 for rums, because there has never been such a geographically diverse availability of rums in the world ever. Until now. Interesting times. Let's start with this slightly hazy and interesting Penny Blue. This really has been a sipper for me. Starting off, you'll notice by the fill level in the bottle, wasn't really getting it. I thought, sure, it's won awards, it's got prizes, blah, 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 so what? Personally, I find this just a little bit lackluster. However, important, whatever spirit we're drinking, wherever we are, once you open the bottle, don't go on the first taste, the first smell. You need to let it oxygenate, settle down, open up, and then come back to it later on. It could be a week, it could be a month, but you may find that there's significant changes. So what's going on here? There's a delightful toffee note. And I really am getting a touch of grain about this. To a whiskey drinker, this will be quite a familiar nose, and there's a very simple reason for that. This rum is matured using ex-whiskey casks. Therefore, we've got a flip going on, as whiskey drinkers will be very familiar with rum-matured whiskies. However, rum drinkers may not be quite so acquainted with whiskey matured rums, but there's quite a few out there. It's just that we don't generally get a description and disclosure of the cask style of cask, size and provenance of casks that rum is matured in. Rum industry or rum distillers really haven't got there yet. A few do, but they're exceptions. Fresh fruit, lovely soft spices, allspice and a little bit of cinnamon, a little bit of dry cedar wood on the nose as well. This is a well-made rum. It's slightly understating. It's got a full body nature to it. It's quite rich, but it's delicate and subtle, like an old cognac on the nose. I've added a drop of water. Remember, this is slightly higher than the usual rum strength, 43.3%. Good. It helps. Sipping it. Creamy, mild toffee, natural sucrose and sugar. Slightly caramel or Caramac confectionery chocolate. Caramelized milk chocolate, we're getting that on the arrival. The after arrival moment, you know, I would call it the development, but funnily enough, it's not like a whiskey development. It's not arrival followed by the development so much as the arrival and then a kind of conclusion of the arrival, but it doesn't feel like it's developing so much as just kind of settling down. So the big event is the arrival in the palate, and then it starts to steadily diminish without evolving too significantly into a nice, gentle, vanilla-infused finish. Let's try again. You can sense, because there's more of a spiciness, a rich, warm spiciness developing now as it opens up in the glass. And you can sense that there's some older rum in here. In fact, the statement is, as I refer to my little notes here, there's rum up to about 11 years old. It's averaging probably about 11 years old. I'm always wary of approaching the producers and asking for information because I should get accurate stuff, but you never can tell. So I'm always better to approach a review entirely from my own perspective in terms of smell and taste and just go on the minimum information that's provided. But produced by the Indian Ocean Rum Company, it's very much geared not as a mixing rum, but as a sipping rum, named after the penny blue, a very, very rare stamp, suggesting it's a very, very rare rum. So a useful association there. Nice, presentable bottle. That's all very well. But let's go back to the palate and see how it's developing. Good quality. Almost cognac, a cognac whiskey-like rum. Quite representative with the clarity of the delivery. Reminds me of Savannah rum, which is a Mauritian rum. Again, an Indian Ocean rum. It has a different style to it, a certain clarity and elegance. Very elegant rum, this, despite its richness of flavour. Good mouthfeel. Certainly benefits from not being chill filtered, which also suggests that they're using pot stills in production. But that is as far as I'll go with this. Rum Mark, I know it's a big award winner and all the rest of it, but it really tries to be a robust rum and delicate rum at the same time. And for me, it's not quite working in that respect. But what I will acknowledge is this is very professionally made. It's very enjoyable. If you were wanting to buy a rum gift for someone who is a whiskey drinker, you would certainly not go wrong in buying this bottle here, and it's not too expensive. So there you go. The fact that you're handing them a bottle of rum, right, with non-chill filtered and natural colour on it, that's got to stand well with any whiskey drinker. So here we are, 86 out of 100. That is a Rum Mark. One last taste before we move on. Slightly harsh in the development. Development's becoming more prolonged now, more less of an afterglow, more of a tangible development. But there's something slightly solvent and soapy in it. I can't quite put my finger on it. And I find it slightly off-putting. But it doesn't take away from the fact that this is a good rum. There you go. Hechicera. What a lovely bottle. Great big stamp on the front. Lots of palm trees around the label. I tell you what, as a northern boy living in the, you know, towards the North Pole, you know, I'm nearer polar bears than a lot of people, put it that way. I just love tropical cliches attached to rum presentation on the bottles. When I see palm trees and sunsets and seashores and shells and that sort of stuff, I know they're cliches, you know, pirate ships, orange colours, sunshiny notes. But I tell you what, I love it. I just love seeing that. And we've got it on here, La Hechicera, the Enchantress, if you speak Spanish, if you read Spanish. And a very nicely presented bottle. The one thing that lets this down, to be honest, is that it's bottled at 40%. If it was a little bit higher, this would be a real tangible contender. Just double checking the strength. Yes, it is 40%. This is from Colombia. And Colombian rums are a kind of fairly recent introduction into Europe. But they've hit the ground running, and this is a very neatly, precisely and professionally blended rum. I've really got to hand it to them. Whoever's put this together has done a really good job. Nose. What have we got in the nose? Rich, warm notes. Some mild treacle. Fantastic. There's a certain spirity to it, but you can tell there's some younger and older rums in here. And they're balancing each other off really quite nicely. Going to add a wee drop of water. I always do. It's partly force of habit, but of course, the thing about habits is they can be good so long as you know when to break them. It has what I would describe as a Guyanan character. Now, Guyana is the home of El Dorado rum, and I'm noticing certain similarities. However, there's some refreshing, slightly dry, dark notes here of burnt licorice and muscovado. Nice, clear muscovado note on the nose. It's also slightly perfumed with the darker perfume notes. Musk and lily. Very nice. Quite singular. Taste-wise, this is good stuff. What I'm really struck with is that the taste reflects the nose and the length of the experience. The arrival is quite a good introduction, but it's the development is that languid, smooth, very nicely produced, professionally, cleanly produced rum that's got lots of mild licorice, toffee, muscovado in it. It's got classic sugar cane notes to it, and they're delivered very nicely indeed. Finish has got a little bit of tea notes and vanilla and honey, touch of honey, which isn't something I usually find in rum. Because it tends to, when you think of honey and rum, it's more of a kind of sucrose, sugar note. I don't know if any additional sugar is added to this rum. For many rums out there, sugar cane juice is added, maybe into the casks or into the spirit, because any additional sweetness will mask any production roughness in the new made spirit. However, I'm not 100% about this. I'm kind of swithering towards it's actually just a well-made rum that has some dominant sugar-connected flavours to it, which are really quite refreshing. Similar to Guyanan rum, but again, that little bit different, which is one reason for buying it. The nose hasn't changed much. I'm going to add a drop more water. Quite a rich rum for being bottled at 40%. If this was bottled single cask at 46%, this would be an absolute belter, particularly if the producers made a very clear statement that there was no additional sugar or any other ingredients. So if they put a provenance declaration in the bottling and put a different coloured stamp on it, keep the bottle, keep everything there, but a different coloured stamp, colour coding, you see, it would really come across well for rum sippers around the world. A beautiful, rich, steady arrival, straight into the development. Bitter notes coming through, very refreshing. Sweet arrival, bitter development. Not a lot of people know that when rum is fermented out completely, it can be really, really dry, and it can start off quite sweet coming out the still, but over time in wood it can really lose that sweet edge, and here we have it losing its sweet edge. So there's some been good active wood involved here, and it's coming across in the final product in the glass really, really nicely. Some mocha, a little hint of coffee in there. I was going to say Blue Mountain coffee from Jamaica because there's a kind of slight nuttiness in there too. However, I don't want to overanalyze, so just take that at face value, rum rascals. And finish. dry muscovado, slightly bitter, very nice, vanilla, yes. Some toasted nuts, some caramac, which is white milk chocolate with caramel in it. There you go. What mark will we give that? I'm going to give that, because this is a rum that really suits my British palate. Britishers, including myself, love the big, dry, bold sugar stuff. It tends to be part of our culture. And this is really, really well presented with this particular bottle. 88 out of 100. On to our next bottle. This is rumblender.nl. Up above my head. Up above my head, I'm going to put the link, the address that you go to have a look at the website. I have to make a disclosure here. The guys that own RumBlender are friends of mine. They're good guys. I insisted in paying for this bottle because that's the way I do it. I don't accept samples, just to let you know, whether it be rum, any other spirits. I like to buy what I review. I just feel safer that way. But here we are. If you want to know the code, my particular blend, rum blender blending code, it is RB for rum blender 48472. And that is Ralphie's Rum Blend. Now, what happens when you go to the website, and this is unique on the internet, but it's exactly the same formula as for Whiskey Blender, and I bought a bottle of Whiskey Blender for reviewing as well. So here we go, a natural progression. Lovely bottle, nice presentation, optional presentation box if you're buying a gift for someone. If you know someone who is a rum fan and you know the general pattern of their taste, whether they like bold rums, smoky rums, light rums, fruity rums, sweet rums, drier rums, well, you might like to compose a blend for them or give your friend the opportunity to create their own blend. There's seven rums in the option and they're given descriptions, and they are, I will name them. There is fruit salad, so quite a fruity rum. Caramel log, so you're getting sweetness there. Old spice, so quite a spice heavy. Rum raisin, so you get fruity note. Candy cane, so again another sweet lighter rum, and smoked pancake, which will be cereal with a little bit of smokiness to it. So you've got this variety of rums. It would be great if you could taste before you blended, but there are certain practicalities involved. And but very nicely presented rum. So how are we going to get on with this? Bottled at 40% again. Be great if it could be higher, but there we go. I was guesstimating my particular blend in this, and I like heavy rums. I like the Caribbean rums. I like the sugar note rums. And that has inevitably influenced my particular blend. Now, the result is, as soon as I put my nose to this, I am getting a huge waft of high ester Jamaican rum with a background of complex spices and wood. And it's really good quality stuff. And I'm not just saying it because I know the guys. What I do know is they have sourced their casks from a Dutch rum house who carry really good stock and have Dutch standards of spirits. In other words, high standards of spirits. Fascinating nose. It's dark. It's muscovado. It's distinctly molasses, but it's really quite refined and complex with it. I must say I've been pleasantly surprised by this. Wee stroll in the glass. It's not a note of rum that I've really come across before, although I recognise the Jamaican component. I also suspect there's a Cuban component in there as well, that spiciness. I suspect there's also a South American I'm not sure whether it's Panama, Central America, or Guyana, or Peru, but there's something that I've never smelt before in a rum there, and I don't quite know what it is, can't quite put my finger on it, and frankly, that's quite a good thing. Taste-wise, lozenge muscovado. Sweet and sour, cough sweets, molasses, cough syrup, menthol, eucalyptus, cherry syrup, all fused together with some quite intense spicy notes, ginger, cinnamon, certainly a touch of clove in the background. And the thing about clove is little goes a long way. There's dry, almost burnt vanilla about this. There's burnt toffee. Fascinating. I'm going to add a drop more water. The one thing that I wasn't sure about to start with was the ability of this rum to open up and kind of develop more complexity in the development on the palate, but steadily it kind of moves there. This is a slow sipper, and a decent rum is just like any single malt or good blended whiskey. You just got to take your time with it. The slower you go, the further you get. Big, complex, relatively simple, but complex with it. So there's complexity in the spirits itself, some relatively young spirit here. But put together in the blend, there's complexity in the just the delivery in the palate. It's a bit of a conundrum, actually. Again, this is a rum. I recognise some of the characteristics, but I've never tasted anything quite like it. And it's taking me a while to get used to it. And that's a good thing because it makes for a more interesting journey. What are we going to give that? A mark out of 100? Out of 100. And that, malt mates, is a rum mark. Rum, rum, rum. I love this stuff, I really do. It is great to challenge our senses because we do institutionalize ourselves over time. Because when we're familiar with something, we're looking to have that familiarity verified. So you'll find as a particular as a whiskey drinker or perhaps as a rum fan, you have your favorites. You'll explore some other options, but you'll always go back to your favorites. However, over time, our palates do change. They evolve. It is part of the experience of just gaining experience in life. It's rather like it's the same with music. It's always good to buy a CD of music you wouldn't normally listen to, but once you've checked it out on the internet to see if it's a good, authentic version of what it is, go for it. I'll tell you what these rums need. I always recommend, if you're a whiskey drinker and you're going to try some rums, put on the right music. Get yourself some reggae, some ska, some two-tone, that sort of stuff. Some calypso. There's plenty of options out there. In fact, you're watching on the internet. Pour whatever you're pouring and look up the accompanying relevant music. Because do you know what? That will help you in your journey. It will. I'm Ralphie. I'm sharing the... Let's remove these so you can see the bottles before I clear off and go and do some further research on other rums for my next review. There we go. Fantastic. 3 Ralphie recommended rums to be explored, to be considered, to be shared, to be savoured, to be sipped. And do you know what? Most of all, to be enjoyed. I'm Ralphie. Come back soon for a few more rums reviews as part of my alternative malt moments. Malt alternatives. Rums. There you have it. There we go. Now you know. See you soon.